So let's hear for the talk of Mathias. Mads, who is Mads? Mads is a curious pet. He's a tech evangelist at Always Data, a cloud hosting company. He has made security and privacy one of his challenges for the web, but all the technologies are under his radar. So to make all the digital players aware of our realities. He also a chronic optimist, so his favorite book will always remain Alice in Wonderland. Please welcome Mathias, who is gonna talk about CDN and performances, and specifically the fonts.
Hi folks, I'm really, really happy to be here for this new edition of We Love Spin, lazy loaded, of course, but yeah, it will be fun. We have just 15 minutes to talk about web fonts and optimization of performances in the web context about typography, so let's go. Be warned before I start it, there will be bad words during this talk, especially something like UA sniffing or something like that. So you're warned. The first question is, should we self-host our Google Fonts? Of course, Google Fonts is here for a while now. And for everyone, obviously, we should self-host our fonts because there is no real advantage to rely on a third-party service to host your fonts. In fact, self-hosting is good because first, it will increase your performances just because you don't have to rely on a third-party service and to depend on it to load your pages and to load your assets. It is a mitigation of the single port of failure because if Google Fonts is not available at some point for any kind of reason, your website will be impacted about it. So you have to mitigate it. And self-hosting is a good way to do it. And it's a privacy and security concern because there could be some kind of tracking of your users. So if your user's privacy count for you, you do have to self-host and do not rely on third-party services to host your different assets. And finally, shared browser cache is a lie because we first use Google Fonts because we thought that if we host the same script or same asset across different sites on the same third-party services, then the asset is already available in the browser cache. But in the last versions of Chrome and of Safari, there is a protection sandbox around the website, which means that the same asset, even if it's loaded from the same subdomain, outside, the cache won't be shared enough across the different websites. So do not count on the shared browser cache anymore. So font statics, fonts are static assets, and we could load it from our website like any kind of other static asset. But there are some peculiarities that you do have in mind when you want to host your font files. So let's back to Google Fonts and how does it work and how you can use it right now. So when you want to use a font in your CSS, you just have to declare a font family for your different kind of items. And you have to declare a font face declaration, which means that the font family name, the style, the weight of the font, and the URL where the font is available to be downloaded and to be loaded from your website. So when you load Google Font Stylesheet, all that you have is a font faces declarations, and you use this declaration to simply use your font face and your using the font family rule in your own CSS. But if you do that, you will have some kind of performances problem because the CSS, you load the CSS from your website. Then your CSS tell the browser that The font faces declarations are hosted in the fonts.googleapi.com domain. So there is another request to request the font, the font faces CSS. Then the CSS is loaded and the CSS is parsed. And then in the CSS, you finally discover that the font file itself is hosted in the fonts.gstatic.com domain. So there is another request to another subdomain to load the font file by itself. So the fonts are loaded extra lightly in your waterfall. And it leads to a problem, which is the Mitt Romney web font problem. During the official curse for the presidency, where Mitt Romney was a probable candidate, Slate.com just published an article titled "Mitt Romney is officially running for president," and the real title is "Mitt Romney is officially not running for president." But the "not" is in an italic version, and the italic font wasn't loaded at the first time, so the message is really not the same one. And this is a debate between: do we have to display the text even if it's unstyled, and then replace it when the font face is available, or do not display the text and wait for it to be loaded before display the text? But there is a risk of missing some contents. So this, there is a lot of options that you can use using the font display declaration in your CSS. Google Fonts suggests to use the font display swap strategy by default, which means that we are just waiting and then displaying the font, the text, even if the font is not available, and then replace it when the font finally is available. But it will lead to a big reflow and a big revamp of the layout, so a big flash of your different text on your web page. Mine, which I prefer, is the font display optional. That means if the font is available, then you use it. If the font file is not available, we fall back to the system font, and the font will be loaded lately and will be available in the cache. And when you refresh the page, then you will be able to use the right font at this time. But this is not a real problem. This is more a UX and a design problem rather than a real performance problem. So we could say, okay, maybe we could preload the font and have it directly available. This is not that easy. Google Fonts suggests that you use a pre-connect instruction that tell your browser to open a connection to the domain where the fonts are hosted to be ready to load the font from this domain. So the font I loaded a bit earlier in the waterfall, but this is not exactly the best solution. The other one is to try to preload the font, but you can't preload from Google Font by itself because the fonts are using hash names. So you can't predetermine the name of the font. And if you can't determine the name of the font, you can't preload it. So what did we learn with that, with Google Font? First things, fonts are static assets. You must avoid to use all domain or use a pre-connect if you can't. Unpredictable names means no preloading. You can do it if you can have the real name. And you have to focus on readability by using the right font display strategy regarding to your context. So what about the self-hosting right now? First one, you can avoid extra CSS call if you use your own self-hosting, because you host everything in your own CSS, and you could still use pre-connect, font display, and other technologies that we previously used with Google Fonts. So let's do it. First step is getting the fonts. So download the fonts from Google Fonts. There is a lot of tools that allow you to do that. You just have to enter the right font family that you want to use, and it will download the fonts, and you can use it directly in your system. Then put your font files in your assets directory and declare the font files by yourself. And this is pretty easy to do, but it leads to a problem. If I do that, the fonts that I load locally are heavier than the ones that are saved by Google Fonts. Why? Because first things, fonts are really, really huge files, so you have to optimize them. And secondly, Google Fonts is a cheater, because When you load a font, there is a lot of characters in it, a lot of glyphs. And what Google Fonts is doing is that it is loading just subset of the fonts, containing only some subset of characters, subset of glyphs, regarding the context, just for Latin or Latin extended or Cyrillic or whatever you want. So there is splitting of the same file. So if you want to do self-hosting, the first thing to do is probably getting separated files, one for Latin, one for Latin extended, and so on, and then declare the correct CSS font face declaration using the Unicode range instructions like Google Font is doing, or create dedicated font files containing only the glyphs that you want to use. But you could probably use SVG rather than a font when you want to reduce just a smaller subset of glyphs. What does it mean about the backend then right now? If you want to do that, you will face some kind of issues with that. For example, if I load a font from Google Font, from Windows or from macOS, I won't have the same file. Why? Because Windows and Linux uses some ints that are computing instructions in the font file by itself regarding to the hinting applied to the fonts during the rendering, and macOS do not do them. But ints instructions are really easier in the font file. So if you can avoid them, you have to do it just to light up the font file. Other thing is that there is different format. If you have to target some Internet Explorer version from 9 to 11, then you have to stick on the WAF format. And rather when number button browsers can use the font, the WAF2 format. And the WAF file are larger and with few features than the WAF2. So you have to adjust, do I have to use ints or no ints? Do I have to use the WAF format or the WAF2 format? And so on. So you have different options if you want to self-host on your own backend. First one, analyze your audience and choose to focus only on the most common use case. If most of your users are coming from Internet Explorer on Windows, then probably serve just WAF files with ints, and that's all. They will be easier for and useless for other modern browsers, but they could apply anywhere. Second one is serve only the best one, WAF2, no ints, and rely on fallback to the system font for the other browsers. The third solution is UI sniffing, and you are detecting the user agent. And with a backend script, you choose to just generate the right font file regarding the user agent that is requesting the font file by itself, or probably mixing all those options to try to find the right way to do it for your context. So just a quick break. In the backend, I will have a font file, full font file. A script will detect the user agent and generate a subset regarding the features expected, the different formats, the different subset of glyphs, and then generate the right sub font file regarding the user agent. Then I store in cache the font file by itself, the subset, and I deliver it to my final user agent. And this is exactly what Google Font is doing. So this is not something that we should avoid. We could do it on our own backend, and we have to do it. But we could do really more. The first thing is probably using the variable fonts. Variable fonts is an extension of the font files format that allow you to store in the same font file all the variations of the different type, different way, different styles of the same font file. So you have different parameters that you can adjust, and using the variable font file, you can just have one file for all the different styles that you want to use in your page. It is really impressive, really efficient, but it is easier than just a single file. So if you just have one file to serve with just one style, you probably have to serve a regular font file. But if you use two or more different variants, different versions of the font, then you do probably have to use a variable font to just serve one file heavier than one, but lighter than two versions to adapt the content. The second solution is the progressive font enrichment. This is another technology when you just serve at first a minimal subset of a font file and then increase the quality by serving patches that will extend the functionalities of the font file. It supports the variable fonts by itself, support a different type of open type features or different type of glyphs, but it is not really ready for production right now. You have some kind of demos, but it's not production proof. But we could simulate some kind of font enrichment by preloading the font. So when you want to preload the font, you have to focus on local fonts, because if you want to preload a font, you first bother to download the font that is probably or optionally available locally. So we may try to detect if the font is already available in the system, but this is based on JavaScript tricks, and there is a lot of false positive or false negative. So you do have to think if it's a good option for you or not. But the best way is probably to serve a minimal subset of font file, no ints, a small subset of glyphs, inline it in the head, then prepare the extended version, and when your document is loaded, then trigger the loading of the full version of the font file, and then the font file will replace, when it will be available, will replace the different glyphs or characters that are missing in the first version with a small version by lazy loading the font file. And this is really easy to do with the font API in JavaScript. So in conclusion, font performance optimization is really hard to do, but we do have to do it if you want to focus on performances. We have to optimize on the back and mix it with technologies in the front. The fact is, there is a lot of front-end pattern. We have a back-end tools and script to improve, but more of them, this is a cursor to adjust between UX, your audience, your context, and what you want to serve. Bad fonts are no exception in terms of performance optimization of static assets. That's all for me. I'm Mads. I'm a tech evangelist at Always Data. We're a cloud provider, and we're working right now on a CDN offer with some kind of pipe technologies that allow you to adapt some kind of assets served on the CDN, like font file optimization. This is why we're doing a lot of research around it right now. If you have some question, we're meeting with Q&A session just right now. And for everything else, thank you very much for your attention. Thanks.
So we are back, and yes, Matt is among us. So yeah, happy to have you, Matthias. So thank you for the talk, and we have some questions about your talk. So let's start with the first one, and the first one is about WAFD. So in 2021, is it reasonable to use WAFD as an only this format?
Well, I guess it depends on your context, because WAFD is perfectly supported in modern browsers. So you could only use WAFD if you want. But if you have to target some other platform or old browsers like old Internet Explorer versions, especially with if you want to serve some website or some web apps to the Asia platform, then you do have to deal with the old WAFD format. So the format is here for a long while, I guess.
Okay, thank you. Next questions. For a long time, you know that the developers used to put icons into font files. Would you still recommend this kind of technique?
Oh, well, definitely not. not anymore. It was really, really useful a long time ago. But right now, if you do have to use icons on your website or on your apps, I prefer to inline SVGs and refer to the various icon using the Xlink href reference, because it will avoid the issue when your web font is not loaded, and so you cannot have your icons visible on your web page or in your web app. And in terms of accessibility, this is a big issue. So you probably do have to prefer to use embed icons in SVG rather than using the old web fonts.
Okay, totally agree. Next question about subsetting. How to choose between Unicode range in CSS or font subsetting?
I guess you have to do both. In fact, the font subsetting allow you to just extract a part of your web font file and just set the regarding glyphs that you want to use. And used with the Unicode range rule in CSS, you explicitly declare to your brother that the font file that you are saving is containing a specific range of glyphs. So so you do have to do both. You just generate a set of different subset of files containing a subset, different subset, and load them in your CSS using Unicode range to tell your brother which one to use if he had to render the correct glyph.
Okay. Next question about preloading. Is it possible to preload subsetted font files, ideally in a HTML tag like link rel preload Unicode range? Do you know if it's possible?
It would be useful, especially in context of internalization. But you can do that. You cannot use a Unicode range attribute in your HTML. But what you could do is to detect the brother language in the backend and serve the right HTML file containing the right link tag with the correct font file to use containing the correct glyphs and the correct font subsets. So this is a kind of mix between the two. You have to detect it on the backend, but you are allowed to preload the font file directly with the correct HTML.
Okay, thanks. And another question about Google Fonts. So from Barry, given all the optimizations Google Fonts do you still think it's always recommended to self-host these fonts?
Well, yeah, good question. I guess self-hosting is a good thing, not only because performances, but also because this is a real mitigation of a single port of failure. So we probably should avoid to use too much third party services on our web page and our apps. So I definitely for the self-hosting rather than using a third party service for privacy, security, and availability concerns.
Yeah, especially in the critical rendering path.
Yeah.
Okay. And the last question from Boris, to minimize CLS when swapping, you either have to choose a web font that is close to a system font or use CSS transform the system font to be closer to web font. Do you have any tool to recommend to do this kind of optimization?
Good question. I don't have any this kind of tool right now, but there's probably something that exists. I will have a quick survey about it and trying to find some kind of tools available to do that and put the links later. But just right now, I don't know any tools available to do that. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So we're done with questions. So thank you very, very much for being a part of this event, and double thank you because you do a double talk in French and in English. So see you, and thank you so much. We're going next.
Thank you.
Yeah, sorry.